Hey, before we get into this, I would just like to ask a big favor because recently most of my videos have been demonetized and I have not gotten a lot of ad revenue from YouTube. I'm not asking you to do this, but if you'd like to, please go to the Patreon and subscribe. I'm going to be putting more content out there over the coming months, and it really does help out in the long term. It's not obviously a full paycheck, but it helps me buy things for the channel. Such as, you know, better lighting that I'm going to have because I'm going to start doing face camera videos more, stuff like that. So if you feel like you want to subscribe, please go and subscribe. Thank you. Jared Fogle is an intriguing person, in a lot of ways not involving his gross shit. Jared was the face of a national company, a spokesman for one of the largest growing franchises in the world that has over 41,000 locations in over 100 countries. Half of them, over half actually, are based in the United States. It's one of the largest chains ever. You might think of Starbucks and McDonald's, but Subway's bigger. Subway's massive. You can find Subways in Walmart, you can find Subways gas stations, you can find Subways everywhere. And one person who found a Subway was Mr. Jared Fogle. Jared Fogle was born in Indianapolis in 1977, graduated from North Central High School, then Indiana University, where he eventually, as Jared Fogle was heavily overweight, very obese, and would eat a lot in his life. He at one point weighed 425 pounds. He didn't exercise, he kept eating junk food. A traditional story. Jared, as he was going to IU in Bloomington, he decided to go to a Subway restaurant and eventually started to change his eating habits. While he was eating at Subway, he ate smaller portions that were free of stuff like mayo and all that, and he lost about 200 pounds, which is an inspiring story. It's such an inspiring story that a Subway franchisee took that story to Subway's ad agency, and they ran a massive campaign. Yeah, on January 1st, 2000, they had pitched the Subway diet. For Jared, was a lot of walking and Subway. It was smaller portions, smaller amounts, and different food. And it worked, and that's impressive. That should not be downplayed. However, Jared himself ended up being an awful person. We'll talk more about that in a little bit, but I want to talk about how the fact that Jared, this random guy who he lost weight, was a fucking celebrity for a little while there. He would appear in WWE things.
I had a feeling that you would say no, Jared. That's why I'm prepared to make an example out of you. And I'm going to make an example out of you right now. Luke, Serena, go get me Jared from
Wait
Subway.
A minute.
Are you ready?
He filmed hundreds of commercials, made appearances all across the country and the world at Subway locations. Funny story, in fact, I actually had met Jared Fogle when I was young. I don't have any photos because, as far as I know, the only person that had them was my grandmother, and those possibly burnt up in a fire. I don't remember which house it was because it's been so long ago. Jared had made an appearance at one of the Subways that we were at, that we, you know, we were near. And we took, I believe, like a couple photos, and he shook my grandparents' hand. And it's weird to think that, with everything that has happened, it's weird to think that met someone who was a celebrity for, I personally think, one, no real reason. I think that Jared's celebrity was strange. You know, it's something that you don't think about, but now, looking back at it, it's odd that this man was so famous, this whole celebrity, this, you know, fame built around him. He made appearances in Sharknado films, for fuck's sake. Here's his cameo from Sharknado 2.
You should really be eating fresh too, you know.
And he had a planned appearance in Sharknado 3.
We induct another cultural icon, the pants of Jared Fogle of Subway.
By eating fresh at Subway, making healthy habits, my pants!
Michael from the future here. I forgot to also bring up the fact that he was in the biggest masterpiece ever made, Jack and Jill. And here's that whole fucking clip, because it is comedy gold.
Really, it's fascinating. How does it work, Mr. Subway Sandwich? Tell me more.
Just Jared's fine.
Call you Jared? Okay, sure. Just 10 sandwiches a day. To me, that seems too much, almost like a job. I couldn't do that.
I don't need that many.
No? Okay. Here's the situation. You're here. There's not a Subway in sight. You're at a steakhouse like this. What do you eat?
I eat other things.
Oh, you do? Yes. You do? I knew you were cheating. That's why there's so much goo left on you. I miss the old Jared. The 400-pound Jared that scared us.
I don't miss that one at all.
Well, I'm sure you don't, but if he was around, he'd be with me and not with the two hookers.
Jared's fame helped him build a lot around him. He was famous, he had a couple kids, he got married a couple times around all this. And everything seemed fine. He even started a foundation, a nonprofit that was focused on raising awareness about childhood obesity. Which is important. You know, childhood obesity is a major problem in our country and in our world. We have tons of kids who are unhealthy because we eat junk. There's no denying that. However, the Jared Foundation was kind of a dark place. In 2007, Jared Fogle had kind of came to attention to the FBI and various state authorities after a journalist and radio host, Rochelle Herman Walrond, which I'm going to just call Rochelle from now on, told a police department that he had made lewd comments to her about middle school-aged girls. She had met him at a middle school for an event, and he was in Sarasota for a speaking tour. She recorded his remarks, saved texts between them, and went to the FBI. The FBI had asked her to essentially kind of be their inside man, their mole, as it were. For the next 4 years, she befriended Jared and recorded everything. Remarks about having sex with girls, asking to install a webcam in her children's rooms, all that. However, the FBI couldn't pursue a case against them because the recordings they needed. They couldn't pursue a case against them because the recordings needed more substantial evidence. You can say anything. In the United States, we have the ability to say whatever we want. Just because you say something doesn't mean you do. However, this is where we have to talk about a man named Russell Taylor, who was the director of the Jared Foundation. On April 29, 2015, Russell Taylor was arrested at his home in Indianapolis on charges of child exploitation, possession of child pornography, and voyeurism. Fogle publicly severed ties to him afterwards, and Taylor attempted to kill himself on May 6th. He was placed on life support, sadly did not succeed. Taylor then pleaded guilty to the charges and was sentenced to 27 years in federal prison. Russell Taylor, according to a USA Today article, had embezzled at least a good majority of $73,000 a year into his own salary. And only one quarter of the funds, more than one quarter of those funds were unaccounted for, per the tax records. The Secretary of State of Indiana had dissolved the organization in 2012 because it didn't pay the required $5 reporting fees during the 2 years prior. So that's intriguing. During that investigation of Russell Taylor, though, authorities had discovered that Taylor had been trading nude photos and videos of kids, some even as young as 6 years old, with Jared Fogle. He became an unindicted co-conspirator in the FBI's case against Jared Fogle. And what they had found on his home and his computers essentially had led them to Jared Fogle, according to Tim Horty, a spokesman for the United States Department of Justice. On July 7th, 2015, the FBI and the Indiana State Police jointly had raided Fogle's home in Zionsville. His residence was torn apart, computers and other electronics were removed, and Subway, that same day, had said that they and Fogle had mutually agreed to suspend their business relationship. I don't know if Jared had a lot of, control in that one. The FBI had also gathered a series of text messages made in 2008 between Fogle and a Subway franchisee named Cindy Mills, with whom he was having a sexual relationship at the time. Fogle had talked about sexually abusing children in age from 9 to 16, told her to sell herself for sex on Craigslist, and asked her to arrange him to have sex with her 16-year-old cousin. Her lawyer had said she alerted Subway's corporate management about said text messages. They responded because Fogle was not a Subway employee, there was no violation. Subway had eventually came out and said they didn't have any record, but it's not surprising. Now, federal prosecutors announced they reached a deal with him to plead guilty to two different counts. One was the distribution and receipt of child pornography, and one of traveling to engage in illicit sexual conduct with a minor, specifically from Indiana to New York City, where he is charged with paying to engage in sexual acts of a 17-year-old girl. It's also alleged that he offered adult prostitutes a finder's fee to find him younger sex partners. He also agreed to pay more than $1.4 million in restitution, which would equal to $100,000 to each of his victims. He faced up to 50 years in prison had he gone to trial. However, because of a plea deal, and because nothing fair ever happens in this world, prosecutors agreed to seek no more than 12 and a half years. In return, he would agree to a minimum sentence of at least 5 years. Soon after the plea deal was announced, Subway had completely severed ties with him. As a part of his plea deal, he also would have very supervised or restricted contact with minors upon approval of his probation officer. Supervised visits of own children would be only allowed with approval of their mother, and I don't think she was going to do it. Upon release from his prison, he would be required to register as a sex offender for the rest of his life, which I don't think is enough. I'm sorry, when you abuse a child, I don't think that is anywhere near enough. On November 19th, 2015, Fogle had formally pled guilty before federal judge Tanya Pratt. In a statement, he apologized for his crime, saying he wanted a chance to become a good, honest person and redeem his life after being ensnared in a life of deception, lies, and complete self-centeredness. According to Dr. John Bradford, a forensic scientist who testified for Fogle's defense team, Fogle suffered from a compulsive eating disorder for several years before losing said weight, and replaced food with a sense of hypersexuality, which included mild or weak pedophilia. A diagnosis was not accepted by experts in the psychiatric field, was criticized by Judge Pratt, and on social media. Liberty Behavioral Health Corp psychologist Adam Dimming suggested Bradford meant to say Fogle's primary sexual attraction was to early teenagers, but he had lesser attraction to younger children. Which in a way, I do believe. I think that when you replace something obsessive, it becomes replaced with something else. If you try to quit cold turkey when it comes to cigarettes, you'll end up going back on it. I think that if Jared took a good step in his life by replacing the food that he loved, you know, he ate a lot of that food. When you replace something like that and you don't replace it healthily, which I'm going to say this very nicely, changing your whole diet to Subway is about the same as, you know, eating cat shit. You could do it, you could lose weight from it, but if you're going to do it slow. Pace yourself. But you also shouldn't do it with Subway, do it with, you know, actual food. Sorry, I'm not a fan of Subway. Yes, no, Judge Pratt had sentenced him to 15 years and 8 months in prison, over 3 more years than what prosecutors had sought and 3 times what Fogle had requested. I believe that he should have served over 50, but that's just me. After serving his sentence, he'll be on supervised release for the rest of his life. Pratt also fined him for $175,000 and ordered him to forfeit $50,000 in assets, in addition to the $1.4 million restitution. Fogle's lawyer, Ron Elberger, filed a notice of appeal on December 14, 2015. Fogle is able to appeal the sentence since it is longer than the maximum sentence requested by prosecutors. Appeal brief was due by January 25, 2016, but Fogle filed for an extension after Elberger was diagnosed with cancer. The extension was granted. After the appeal was filed, the U.S. Attorney's Office responded by opposing any sentence reduction. The office cited Fogle's text messages with a woman, in which Fogle said he would pay big if she could procure 14-year-old children, and that he craved underage Asian girls. In these text messages, he also expressed sexual interest in young boys, and a recording exists where he describes to a friend a sexual encounter with a male child. Fogle's lawyers recommended that he served his sentence in the Federal Correctional Institution in Inglewood near Littleton, Colorado. However, he would end up arriving at the Henderson County, Kentucky Detention Center, where he was held temporarily until he entered the Federal Bureau of Prisons custody and ended up in Oklahoma City. He was then transferred to Inglewood, where in 2016, Jared Fogle was assaulted by this hero, Stephen Nigg. Nigg hates child molesters, and the attack left Fogle with a bleeding nose, swollen face, and scratches on his neck. Stephen was transferred from there to Oklahoma City before being then transferred to El Paso, Texas. Stephen, keep up the good work. Beat every pedophile you see. I think the point I wanted to make, the main reason I'm making it part of the old series here, is the question I have of how do we balance fame and responsibility? Should Jared have ever been famous? The answer, I don't think so. It's incredible how he lost his weight, and it's good that it could have brought someone some kind of joy. If someone who wasn't inspired by their own lives took an inspiration from Jared at that time and lost weight, that is a net good. but the fact that Jared had abused what fame he had to abuse children, the fact that there was nothing done about it for so long, even though it was known. It was known since 2007. It's disappointing. The fact that Jared, someone who a lot of us, I assumed, you know, was an average person. A guy who, you know, his fame was, I lost weight by eating sandwiches, you can too, ended up being a monster. And we see it all the time. When it comes to YouTube, I think the biggest example in recent history has been Austin Jones. You know, Austin Jones, what was this pretty boy, this handsome YouTube celebrity, this musician who was pretty good at music, I'm not gonna lie, but we eventually found out that he had such a dark history behind him and a dark story around him. It's hard to look at that in any other way than he's a monster. You still have to realize there were people that loved his music, there were people who cared about his music, much like with Jared Fogle, there were people that cared about that story inspired. Losing 245 pounds is not an easy task for most people. I guess the best way I can describe it and look at it is, the people that gained something from Jared in that 15-year gap where he was a spokesperson from 2000 to 2015, that's a good that happened in the world. But the Fogle's acts after, Fogle's acts during and after are horrifying, are undeniably horrifying. The fact that he only is serving 15 years for that, the fact that the earliest date that he will release is July 11th, 2029, which is 9 years from now, 8 years from now, actually. The fact that we are that close to seeing a man who abused that many children walk free is horrifying. And it should horrify you, but sadly, there's not much we can do. And the only thing I can say is, we need to learn from the Jared Fogles in our world, and we need to improve. Not everybody should be famous. Not everybody should be a spokesperson. There's a reason that we should look into the people we idolize or respect, or even are intrigued by. And I think Jared Fogle was someone who was respected. But with that, I say that hopefully Jared Fogle gets what's coming to him. Hopefully every single one of his victims can find some sort of peace. And with that, I lead to the Patreon outro. Thank you and have a good night. And now at our Patreon outro, I want to mention, if you want to be a Patreon or if you want to become a channel member, go down below, click the link, the Patreon or the channel membership button down below. It's a little join icon. Helps me create content, helps me focus on creating content, and helps me work on more stuff in the long term for everybody. Not doing the greatest when it comes to finances, but I'm not going to ask if you don't want to or if you can't afford. If you can, a dollar a month gets you access to pretty much everything right now. I'm working on revamping stuff for $5 and $10 tier patrons, but those announcements are going to come sometime in October. With that, at our $10 tier, we have Annie, Amorette, Some Jagass, and Pumpkin Spices. At our $4.99 tier, we have Augie Burns. At our $1 tier, in no alphabetical order, we have Zero Tregnier V. I'm going to be awful at that name. That's a new patron. K.Shea, Josh Boyles, Baleborn, Kim W., Lyra, and Charlie. And then in our YouTube channel memberships, we have Waterbender and the Weed Sama. Both have been around for a little bit on here, so if you want to become a channel member, if you want to become a patron, both get you the same rewards. Both are going to get you the same rewards when I revamp the $10 and $5 tier as well. But if you want to be a part of those, click down below. There's a link in the description to Patreon. There's also a link, that little join icon if you're on PC. I don't know what it's like on iOS. Little join button on Android. Anyways, working on a Stadia review. Also, going to have some Xbox Series X stuff when that happens. We're going to do some gaming stuff related, like some reviews, like the Stadia review. That's a big plan. That'll be in November. I don't entirely know what we're working on for October, but I got a couple ideas that I'm gonna research and spitball as we lead into October. I'm gonna try for 2 videos a month as well. If you're watching this right now early, you're watching us on Patreon, again, or channel membership. Yeah. All right. Take it easy. Be safe, folks. Have a good one, and I will see you next time.